Welcome to the Tapestry of Life. I'm Dr. Pascal Scoles, Professor of Behavioral Health and Human Services at Community College of Philadelphia. Today's topic is HIV/AIDS and behavioral health issues. AIDS is now the fourth leading cause of death among women of childbearing age in the United States. Substance abuse compounds the risk of AIDS for women, especially for women who are injecting drug users, IDUs, and who share drug paraphernalia because HIV/AIDS often is transmitted through shared needles and other shared items such as syringes, cotton swabs, rinse water, and cookers. In addition, under the influence of illicit drugs and alcohol, women may engage in unprotected sex, which also increases their risk for contracting or transmitting HIV/AIDS. According to the National Commission on AIDS, injection drug users, minorities, men having sex with men, are disproportionately affected by HIV disease. African American men and Hispanics, MSMs, compared with their white counterparts, are more likely to inject drugs and to engage in high rates of unprotected intercourse. Sociocultural factors combined with community values, machismo, family loyalty, sexual silence, and lack of access to health care strongly compete with safe sex and drug practices among gay and bisexual men of color. According to the CDC, during 2004 through 2007, a total of 152,917 persons received a diagnosis of HIV infection in the United States. The majority of HIV-infected IDUs, 62.2%, were male. By race, ethnicity, blacks or African Americans accounted for 57.5% of HIV-infected IDUs. Whites were 21.4%. The average annual rate of new HIV infection diagnosis for 100,000 general population during 2004 and 2007 was 11 for blacks or African Americans, 4.9 per 100,000 for Hispanics or Latinos, and less than 0.1 for whites. To discuss some of the above healthcare challenges, I want to introduce my special guest, Lee Carson, from Public Health Management Corporation, Sade Holland from Partnership Comprehensive Care Practice, Drexel University, and Robert Burns, who is the Executive Director of Colors, which is the oldest and only organization in Philadelphia exclusively providing HIV prevention services to black men who have sex with men. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Sade, can you tell me a little bit about what you're doing and the organization that you're working with now?
Yes. I'm the program coordinator for Drexel University College of Medicine, where I oversee an intervention called Protect and Respect, which provides education services to primary HIV-positive women about preventing secondary transmission to their partner. Also within my care practice, I do prevention counseling, also couples counseling with serial discordant couples talking to either the man or woman is positive and their partner is negative, and just really enforcing risk reduction techniques, condom use, how to hold conversations with their partners about practicing safe sex, and also encouraging their partner to get tested for HIV as well.
Could you give us a little feel for what you say to them? You know, kind of the information that you give them?
Yes. Well, first and foremost, for my woman who is HIV positive, I always encourage her to always remember that this is about her, that her body is her temple, and furthermore, that her body is now more susceptible to other infections. If she does not feel comfortable talking with her partner, that I encourage her to bring her partner in so we can work on a conversation. But first, I'll talk to her about what kind of practices do her and her partner do as far as sex. Do they use condoms? How often do they use condoms? What kind of condom works for her? If she's not comfortable with using a condom, let's see what ways we can make condoms fun. So we also do a lot of role playing. I give her tips about where she can leave condoms around the house. But furthermore, making sure that my client is comfortable before we bring her partner in. And if her partner is comfortable with coming in, for the most part, they are. They're really understanding of what's going on. But for the most part, their partner isn't really knowledgeable of HIV. Mm-hmm. They just know that I understand that's what she has. But they don't understand the importance of why she needs to use a condom, why coming to the doctor is important, and furthermore, why taking her medication is very important as well.
Okay, well, we'll get back to some of that because there's some, I guess, interesting discussions that occur that would be interesting for the audience to kind of get a sense of that.
Okay.
Robert, what I know you're doing this great work with Colors.
Yes, I've been an executive director for about the last year now. So as June of 2010, I became the executive director of the Colors organization. And primarily what our organization does is a lot of work around working with the African-American, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender community, so mm-hmm. LGBT community for short. And we really do that through a lot of different ways. Our primary mechanism is really through providing comprehensive HIV and STD screening. So we provide HIV rapid testing in our organization. We do screening for chlamydia, gonorrhea, and hepatitis yeah. C, and we'll soon be doing syphilis screening as well.
And STDs are
sexually transmitted diseases.
Yeah.
So we've been doing that work. That's primarily since the beginnings of our organization, which we started in 1991 doing this work, really around creating a mechanism for empowering African-American LGBT individuals, because oftentimes there just was not a voice, particularly when it came to the HIV movement and what was going on with the epidemic at that time, for primarily for Black gay men. We also do multiple psychosocial support groups. Mm-hmm. So Monday through Thursday, we do different groups that target different parts of the population. So we have our positive men's group that, you know, focuses on working with men and having a conversation about living with HIV and how to live, you know, live more healthy with the disease. We also have our social exchange, which is our youth drop-in group, which is kind of our crown jewel, because this is where our young people get an opportunity to get involved and get connected to the organization and some of the resources that are out there and available to them. So it's very busy and hectic on our Tuesday nights. We also have our Sisters United, which is our transgender women's group that's been operating for the last six to nine months, that really focuses on the needs of the African-American transgender male to female population here in the city of Philadelphia. Wednesdays, we have our Men of Color United group, which really just kind of focuses on the broad issues that Black gay mm-hmm. men or men who have sex with men are going through and experiencing. So they get an opportunity to talk about that on Wednesday evenings. And then we have our 40 Acres of Change group, which is really focused on having those intimate conversations with our young people. So Tuesday, they get to be social, mm-hmm. come together and build community. On Thursdays is when we kind of get into the nuts and bolts about how life is for them and really kind of addressing some of the social determinants for risk for HIV. Because oftentimes what we recognize in our agency is that HIV is not paramount when it comes to looking at the whole totem pole of things. So it's not at the top of their list. So they're addressing issues around poverty, employment, you know, health access. So what our jobs oftentimes is really trying to identify the resources that can support them around those needs. And once they're supported, then that can reduce their, you know, their likelihood for risk for acquisition and or transmission of the HIV virus. Mm-hmm.
What kinds of, if you don't mind sharing, what kind of conversations go through those groups? I mean, informationally, and how do you kind of talk to people who maybe are not really totally sure that they need to have all this information?
So. The conversations vary. I mean, it runs very basic to some of the conversations that you mentioned about, you know, HIV 101 and really educating folks about the HIV epidemic and, you know, how it is transmitted. It could be as very as basic to that, to really talking about looking at how support systems are important in your life. You know, oftentimes in the African-American LGBT communities, we're looking at the issues of biological families, those that you're, you know, born from, your mother and your father, you know, the family that you're, you know, connected to from birth. And then we talk about logical families in the African-American LGBT communities. These are the families that you kind of create yourself, mm-hmm. the individuals that you bring around you that are going to support you in your life development process. And oftentimes amongst African-American LGBT individuals, it's usually that connection to logical families, because oftentimes those are going to be the individuals that are going to provide support around the multiplicity of issues that are going on in their lives. So whether it's addressing their sexuality, or maybe it's addressing addiction, These are what sometimes you'll see happening, play out in logical family structures. Mm-hmm. And there is a support and a connection to biological families, but sometimes there's different, you know, these different family circles provide for different sets of conversations. Yeah. And oftentimes in our agencies, we're helping individuals navigate those conversations. Mm-hmm.
I guess like every group, there some of us feel comfortable with the population of people that share our experiences, mm-hmm. and that our biological parents sometimes don't really share some of our experiences. So,
and may not understand the best way to kind of, you know, translate mm-hmm. that information. So, you mm-hmm. know, sometimes, you know, I think that there's a struggle with parents and, you know, biological kind of like, you know, nuclear family structures that have a difficult time understanding what it is around sexual identity, mm-hmm. Gender identity for those individuals who are maybe transitioning from male to female or female to male. So oftentimes, I think having that natural connection to individuals in the LGBT community seems to be a better fit. So often our organization helps, you know, mitigate some of those concerns by working with individuals to kind of talk about, you know, what is it, what does it mean to go through a transition, right. whether it is I'm coming out and I'm coming into my sexuality, or I don't think that, you know, my body doesn't match with what I identify with. Mm-hmm. So we address those conversations because they're very much interconnected into risk for HIV, because if I don't feel good about myself, you know, then I'm not going to make, you know, feel, you know, healthy or loving decisions around whether or not I'm going to use a condom, for example, right. oftentimes is the case.
Yeah, and I think this is this has been a great start to the conversation and to maybe sort of segue into what are some of the most important things that you think people need to know about HIV in Black communities, because you represent the two segments of the community that are hardest hit by HIV, African-American women and African-American MSM. And so, Sade, I don't know if you want to start off by sort of talking about what do you think are some of the most important things that people need to know about HIV among Black women?
To sum it up easily, it's real. I think after 30 years, people are still not understanding mm-hmm. that HIV didn't come yesterday. It didn't just stop by real quick to say, hey, I'm here. It's something that's real, and it's taking over families, and really it's taking over the Black community to the point where, hey, we may be extinct. It's sad to say that I have some clients who are very young, maybe about 14, 15 years old, that I would see at one of the adolescent clinics, who probably became infected because, you know, they were in love. And for the most part, they were looking for that fatherly figure out there. And here was this young man just saying a few things to her. And she didn't understand the importance of using a condom. She didn't understand why having that conversation was important. And at 15, I mean, hey, I think you're still in middle school, entering into high school. So a conversation about sex isn't something that's firsthand. Mm-hmm. Also, what's very important is that women understanding self-love, self-acceptance, self-esteem is always big, regardless if they're young or older, understanding that I am somebody and I'm worth something, and that just going out here, not just saying necessarily just going out here, but being in a relationship and just not using a condom, and set aside not using a condom, but really understanding that I am at risk. HIV, any other STD that is out here, and being able to facilitate a conversation with your partner. I'm always hounding my clients about that. Being able to talk, and sometimes Black women, we can talk about everything else. Girl, your hair looks good. Look at your nails. I love your nails. But we're not saying, hey, sis, you know, I seen something on TV about HIV. I hear it's very serious. What do you know about it? Well, how about we go get tested together? Mm-hmm. You know, taking a friend by a hand, taking a loved one. I mean, my parents, I'm kind of young, were engaging in unprotected sex if I'm here. So who's to say they weren't at risk or that they're not infected? People aren't having these conversations at the dinner table. People aren't having these conversations on long car rides. So really, I think in the Black community, it's being able to talk and understanding that this is serious. We can talk about everything else, but HIV, we don't want to talk about it until it hits home. Mm-hmm. And even then, that conversation is still hard.
Mm-hmm. Is there, I just want to ask you another question. Is there anything that you would recommend to parents? Because I think a lot of parents struggle with how to talk to a young person. How early do you suggest that parents talk to their children about HIV and AIDS, about sexuality, and any tips that you have for them about engaging them in that conversation?
Definitely. I think for every parent, it depends on their parenting skills and what they feel comfortable with, because a lot of parents don't feel comfortable. So if they don't feel comfortable, maybe getting online, looking up some different resources and places right here in the city of Philadelphia that is able to help them navigate that conversation, or will they feel comfortable bringing their children in. Maybe a conversation with their physician. I know that could be kind of challenging, because some doctors may look at you like, why are you having this conversation with your 13, 14-year-old? But really discussing to them, hey, this is serious, this is real, I need some help. Looking for different games or activities online. There's a lot of resources online. If you do not have access to resources online, coming downtown, Colors Organization is great. Partnership Comprehensive Care Practice, there's also Babashi. There's tons of organizations in the city of Philadelphia that provide educational services, not just to people who are infected, but those just in the community who just need that information, the education.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you.
I mean, I think the biggest theme that you can get from it is communication. I think that that's going to be utterly the crux of being able to address the epidemic in an African American community, because we don't talk about it. I think normalizing the conversation around how the HIV epidemic is impacting and ravaging, communities of color. And I think that once you begin to have some of those kind of conversations in a very normal setting, whether it's on a car ride, whether it's on a plane ride, a train ride, riding SEPTA, I think that that's really going to be able, you'll be able to bring about a different type of change within the community. It's really going to take community mobilization. And I mean a very significant community mobilization effort that, you're inundated with the messages. I mean, when you think about when the epidemic first started in the 80s, and during the Reagan administration, it took a long time for even our president at the time to be able to talk about HIV and AIDS and to say it. And that epidemic was ravaging white gay men at the time. And then now we're seeing kind of a flip in the reality that is now ravaging communities of color. Mm-hmm. And that same type of push and urgency that should be happening in communities of color is not happening on a significant enough scale to kind of stem the tide of the epidemic. So I think that, communicating, whether you're straight, gay, or anywhere in between, because we have to recognize sexuality is very fluid. Mm-hmm. I think that we get so caught up on the aspects, okay, it's a gay disease, or, it's this type of disease, I don't need to worry about it, it's not me. Realizing that sexuality is so fluid that it can happen to anyone, and really being very clear that we can't allow that to, be a veil that will kind of disguise itself and think that we don't have to have the conversation because it's not going to impact me. I think that once we do that, that'll be really going to be, it's going to be key.
Yeah. And there's, you mentioned it started in the early 80s. And at the time, I was a therapist and running a practice out of 12th and Walnut, which, the old 13th Street Businessmen's Association. There was a lot of activity in that community. And the two populations were actually gays and drug users. Mm-hmm. They were the two originally, and they were predominantly white, as you mentioned. And at that time, it was more like you were dealing with death and dying when you would do counseling, because they were dying at a fairly large rate at the time, because we didn't have all the wonderful medications that we have right now. Mm-hmm. Could maybe either one of you talk a little bit about the movement through that that kind of period and how the medications have really extended people's lives to the point where it's not even the death issue doesn't even come up anymore.
It's significant. I think that folks are, it's not, you're not dying from HIV.
That's right.
It's like you're living chronic with HIV. It's a chronic disease now, very similar to, diabetes.
That's right.
In communities. And I think recognizing that, these antiretrovirals, if you're actively seeking care, that's the biggest key. I think that oftentimes, folks are reluctant, and in communities of color, it's most significant. We have a higher level of reluctance to want to go to the doctor's office. Whether something is aching, bruising, we're going to use grandma's common remedy to kind of take care of it. Yeah. And I think that when it comes to, understanding, the impact of the HIV epidemic, that we have to be much more diligent about staying connected to the care services, because the antiretrovirals can do it. I mean, now we have a treatment regimen, a triplet, you can take it once a day. It's a triple drug combination, therapy that you take in one pill a day that, really can kind of extend, the health outcomes around, addressing the HIV epidemic for that individual. But again, if you're not engaged in care and making sure that you're consistently talking to your physician about, well, this is how the medication is impacting me, I think that this is going on, and really kind of having those very critical conversations, mm-hmm. And having a support system around you, there's going to be a level of reluctancy that those medications will work for individuals. Sure.
Mm-hmm. So the issue really starts to become more like, it's not really a medical, I mean, there is the medical issue, like you mm-hmm. say, like diabetes, HIV. The issue really becomes a social community, engaging people in the discussion so that they will, one, go to their physician, get tested.
Exactly.
And basically work on safe sex.
Right. Stigma plays a big part of that.
Stigma, yeah.
Stigma
mm-hmm.
plays a part of that conversation because, you know, me acknowledging that I am dealing with this disease, you know, means that I have to acknowledge all the other things that are going on in my life. Mm-hmm. And for individuals out there, there's still some challenges around how will people see me? Because,
right.
you know, I could tell you I got diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
I could tell you that, you know, I'm doing the finger stick and, you know, I'm taking my mm-hmm. insulin. But it's a different conversation when I tell you I'm taking my medication because I'm HIV positive. It's a very different conversation, and I think that, you know, addressing stigma is going to be critical.
Yeah. And, you know, you often wonder, like, if you're with someone, you don't necessarily have to say to them, oh, I'm diabetic. But if you're with someone, you know, you have to have the dialogue,
right.
As opposed to some other
right.
medical problems, which you don't necessarily have the dialogue because there's not the same
yeah.
intent
yeah.
that happens
not,
to them.
Not so. A communicable disease.
Yeah, exactly.
And so, like, one of the things, Sade, you had mentioned earlier was serodiscordant. And so I'm not sure if everyone knows
yes.
what that means. So if you want to talk a bit about what serodiscordant relationships are and how you help women to sort of talk about, as Robert said, you know, the stigma that exists around HIV and how you help women deal with that in the context mm-hmm. of your conversations
good
with
question. Them.
Great. So within my practice, I work with, as you stated, serodiscordant couples where one individual is HIV positive mm-hmm. and another individual is HIV negative. And it can be very touching, especially if there are women who have yet to disclose their status. And again, bringing it back to communication and how do we actually start this conversation?
Mm-hmm.
And this individual now has to look back and maybe they're dependent upon the way they receive their diagnosis. That can haunt them for a long time. Maybe if they got it from drug use, depending upon the way of diagnosis and infection, sometimes a lot of the women are still hurting behind that. So that we have to deal with that first before we even think about mm-hmm. disclose it. And I think a lot of talk shows and radio shows and doctors push disclosing. You need to tell. But what people don't realize is there's a story behind someone's status.
Mm-hmm.
So really having this conversation becomes heavy. It becomes hard because in the theory, I have to get naked in front of this person and really open myself up so they can understand what's going on in my life. And then with that, once we can work through all the kinks and nooks and everything else, then we can say, hey, how do we want to plan out this conversation? Do you want to bring your partner in? Sometimes people feel more comfortable coming up with a scenario like, hey, I went to the doctor. My doctor said I need to get tested for HIV. What do you think about that? Depending upon their partner, they could either have a stroke. Well, I'm not doing nothing. I'm not stepping out. What makes you? Why do I need to get tested? I don't have it. So now that's making her become more resistant and not wanting to say anything. So now she has to come back in. That's another counseling session.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes these counseling sessions can take up to weeks, sometimes months, before disclosure even happens.
Mm-hmm.
And depending upon, again, I'm big on support system. I think the support system is the cure. That's the only way people are able to live and survive.
Mm-hmm.
With any chronic illness, you need that support and that love and understanding that, hey, I can do this. I'm going to make it. You know, that support is going to encourage you. You have to go to the doctor. When's the last time you've been to the doctor?
Mm-hmm.
Do you need a ride?
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot that comes with disclosure is heavy and it's big and in a relationship. But today there are a lot of healthy relationships.
Mm-hmm.
There are a lot of healthy, the partner's positive. Another one is negative. He or she is taking very good care of themselves. Their partner is very supportive. And also the partner is willing to get tested.
Mm-hmm.
Now, sometimes it's a struggle to make sure that they do get tested quite often, but they're still willing to get tested and willing to get educated as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, it all goes back to having that conversation
mm-hmm.
to really be able to have a healthy relationship.
Yeah. When you say tested, I mean, I think we all know what testing means, but what is involved in testing? I know it's simple, but maybe the audience doesn't know that it's out there. What is, when you say tested?
Well, it depends on it depends on who's doing it.
Okay.
I mean, there's different types of testing. There's conventional testing, and then there's rapid testing. Okay. Conventional testing, which some medical offices still provide, you know, the traditional blood draw, send the blood out to the lab, you get your results in usually a week. I'm going to be very kind of like, liberal with that. So usually about a week, you'll know what your test results in. But most of the community-based organizations and even some of the health clinics now provide rapid testing. Right. So you can find out your test results as early as 10 minutes now. So you go in, you get a finger stick, or oral swab, because you can get the oral swab test, or you can get the finger prick. And it's just like very much like a diabetic test. You get one prick of your finger, and it takes a couple drops of your blood. And then within 10 to 20 minutes, you get your test results. It's that simplistic. Generally, most places will offer pre and post counseling during the counseling and testing session. So you're looking at getting tested, and it can last about anywhere from 30, 45 minutes, depending upon what type of questions you might have in that counseling and testing session. But it's a fairly simple process. I mean, it's very easy. But I think that a lot of folks are, intimidated about what's going to be the outcome.
Yeah. Right.
And I think that, that's why it's very important that if you're going to get tested, to have the pre and post counseling, because that helps you get prepared to talk about your risk behaviors. What's going to be the plan if you come back positive? Are you ready for a potential positive test result? What are you going to do, and who are your support systems? And I think that that's very, very key in a counseling session, because a person can get tested and may not be ready for the outcome that comes after it. And if they don't have a support system, now may not be the time. We may need to have a different kind of conversation to get you prepared for whatever the outcome of the test result is.
It's interesting that the one that takes a week, I know that they do manage false positives in the sense that, the follow-up, more extensive test, I forget what it was
confirmatory test.
The Elijah test, that's it. In the brief one, though, how do they manage? I mean, you could be given, I don't know this to be true, I'm asking.
Okay.
The brief one, I would assume that you wouldn't say too much until you had some confirmatory.
Well, if the thing about it is for the rapid test now, it is a two-step process.
Okay.
So particularly for if a person comes back what we call preliminary positive.
That's it. That's
so if the person comes back preliminary positive after a test result, we have to do a confirmatory test, which we would send out to a lab. And it takes about 3 to 5 days, so about a week to get that test result to confirm whether or not the test is actually accurate. I will say that with rapid testing, that the testing itself is about 98% accurate.
Okay.
It has a very high specificity and sensitivity, which means that, it will accurately identify whether or not the person has the antibodies present for the HIV virus. So I think the tests are very reliable.
Okay. And then the follow-up would get you into the 100%
right,
range.
The confirmatory, which would be the ELISA test in a Western blot, which is, if necessary, would be able to do that confirmatory to let you know whether that preliminary positive is actually a true reactive test result.
Right, I think just the distinguisher there, right, is just that the preliminary test looks for antibodies.
Right.
And antibodies could be triggered by a number of things, possibly, and that the ELISA looks specifically for the HIV virus. So that's the delineation between the two tests.
Exactly.
I assumed if your practice was similar to what I used to, we used to role play a lot.
Yeah.
Because you say, what if, just in case.
Your partner said X, how are you going to react to it? And
right.
I assume that that kind of practice is really, really helpful. One, it controls anxiety, it allows you to kind of feel.
Correct.
Is that you do?
Correct. I do. I feel like I'm role play queen.
Yeah.
I do another role play. We do a lot of skits. I hand out little cards that will have who your role will be.
Okay.
So sometimes, I have one example, two college students, one person's positive, one person's negative. But the person who's positive is not to disclose their status. So for example, they could be watching TV, BET especially, they always have something HIV come on in. The student may be like, what do you feel about HIV? And then the person who's positive is trying to hold back because sometimes people who are living with HIV who hear rude or not so nice comments, they want to say something but they don't, so they're kind of stuck in limbo. And it's just seeing how would you feel not disclosing your status. Then there's an example where it's a mother and child, mm-hmm. which is also another big thing that we struggle with, is a lot of our women who are positive who want to tell their kids and just don't know how. And seeing how that conversation would play about. So if you are the mom and you would disclose your status to your child, how would you go about that? Where would you take them? What would the setting be? How would you start off that conversation? And for the most part, sometimes we do the conversation if your partner goes to get tested and your partner comes back positive, but you already knew of your status.
Oh, but you never told.
Right. And
she never told him.
Right. Uh-huh. How do you go about that conversation?
I mean, not being angry or something
right.
like that.
Yeah. And do you actually, when he does come and says to you, no, I went and took this test and it came back positive, do you actually still tell him your status?
What do you normally recommend?
Whew.
that might be situational.
Right.
Yeah, I know.
Depending on
how that is. Honesty kind of is the best policy if they're partners and... You would want
but
to
I
have
think there might be issues around fear of right. violence if the partner may attack.
Right. Domestic violence
so
is always
you have to
big.
Sort of assess that.
Right. And, right. and have them come back and say, hey, let's take a moment.
I mean, the anger might turn into almost domestic issues.
Right. Because right. 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 that's another big key in HIV community is domestic violence.
Mm-hmm.
Even with individuals who are positive and their partner is negative, is them holding that over their head.
Right.
You yeah. know, because that's why you got that stuff. And so now she's fearful,
you
know.
Gonna tell.
Right. Yeah. She doesn't want to leave, so she's just going to stay in this relationship because, yeah. you know, well, he does accept me. He yeah. is there for me, and it's okay if he hits me every so often.
Yeah. I assume that's pretty consistent no matter what partner relationship
you're whether, in. Whether you get whether you're gay or straight. I mean, yeah, I think that the yeah. issue around status disclosure and serial discord in relationships can, you know, be tricky. You know, one positive partner, one negative partner. It's like, you know, how much do I tell?
Mm-hmm.
And then if I do tell, what will be the ramifications if the relationship falls apart? So straight or gay, you have to worry mm-hmm. about, well,
right.
are you going to now tell my circle of friends that True. May not know what's going
Even
on with
my family?
Status? Will you tell my family if I have not mm-hmm. disclosed? You know, you have to worry about, will that be held over your head? And I think that, you know, when it comes to dealing with the epidemic in communities of color, in the black community, I think that we have to figure out how to have those kind of conversations. I think that the interventions, you know, if we go to that conversation, really kind of talk about that, you know, have to build into what do you do if? Because I think the likelihood to be exposed to a positive partner in the black community is going to be higher. I mean, for African-American MSMs, you're looking at 1 in 2 black men who have sex with men being infected on average. That's kind of a national average. So that means if I look to my left and I look to my right, one of the two might be positive. And if we haven't had, you know, a conversation around what does that look like for you, and, you know, really what does it mean around building relationships, it's going to be difficult. So, you know, and that's the same thing, you know, for, you know, our straight community.
Right.
If, you know, we don't prepare ourselves to have those kind of conversations mm-hmm. about HIV status, it's like, you'll be remiss to really kind of, you know, address the epidemic and its impact to the black community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, oh, go ahead, Shade, we're going to say something.
I was just going to kind of piggyback off of you, Rob, and say that I feel like these conversations are happening, but there's billboards everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
There's something on every urban radio station. Mm-hmm. Now the new Greater Than AIDS campaign.
Yeah.
So we're talking about it. We just don't want to hear about it.
Mm-hmm.
Or it just gets a little bit uncomfortable.
But are we talking about it out there in the community? It's on the billboards, as you say. But when I get into the confines of my space, my home, and there's just the two of us,
right.
do I talk about the billboard? I don't know.
So that's kind of where the conversation.
That's where it's falling off.
Exactly.
I mean, I could drive down 95 and see Greater Than AIDS.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can hear you know, Tom Joyner talk about mm-hmm. you know, Wrap It Up campaign, or I can see it on BET Wrap It Up. I can see a Kaiser Family Foundation. Mm-hmm. I mean, I could probably go through the litany of how many prevention messages that are, you know, that are trying to, you know, penetrate the black community. But I think that what happens is we see it, and we still don't know how to talk about it.
That's it.
I think that that's where the translation is lost. And I think that, you know, when we were talking about that communication conversation, how do I take what I see on that billboard and then have the conversation in my household when I know I have a child that's experimenting with their sexuality,
right.
or a child that I know that is experimenting and having sex, period, right. whether gay or straight. I think that we don't know how to translate, I just seen this billboard and I now need to have this conversation, and I don't know what that conversation is.
Right. Yeah.
the tools sometimes are missing.
And I know that there's, you know, some talk about, so there's community level interventions, right? So there's social marketing, which is like what the Greater Than campaign is, which is a national campaign really targeting African Americans. Then there's community level interventions and some that really try to tie in social networks to sort of find key people within social networks and have them go out and talk to people in their networks about HIV AIDS, about, you know, protecting themselves, those kinds of things. Is there any work that you guys have done with any of that type of messaging or prevention efforts?
I know that for Colors, we do community level. We do, you know, as you talked about, there's several layers of interventions. So you have the community level, group level, and then you have the individual level interventions. So it's kind of like working from a micro to macro level. So from a community level intervention standpoint, Colors does that through our role model stories. And what we do is we, you know, go out in the community, kind of do this community identification process and try to identify individuals that are along the spectrum of what we call stages of behavior change. You have folks that are never thought about condom use.
Like the pre-contemplative,
ready for action, action.
Yes.
You know, for our theorists out there.
Yes.
but you know, we really look for individuals that never thought about change, all the way to people that have been maintaining change, and particularly around condom use. And we interview those individuals and we develop role model stories. And what happens is, you know, you may be out there and we have a conversation and you say, you know what, I've never thought about condom use. And so what I would do is I would pull out of my toolkit this role model story that has somebody that has begun thinking about condom use. So I can now and help you initiate, you know, and diffuse a message to initiate some type of behavioral change around your process around condom use. So wherever you are at in regardless of your stage, we would pick the role model story of the individual that's already in the stage ahead of you to kind of get you to be convinced.
To move along.
To move along that continuum. So we do that through our Community Promise Project, and that's very successful for us in our experience doing community level interventions. But, you know, our group level interventions are really kind of focused on trying to change a group norm and behavioral norm. And we've had experience doing that with, you know, for example, we've done Many Men, Many Voices, which is an intervention that specifically works with African-American men who have sex with men or gay identified men. And that process has worked well for us. And then I know now we are working with Lee's organization to do bisexual men's intervention. That's really kind of looking at integrating some social work theory, you know, and doing some of that kind of social work theory and bringing into some behavioral cognitive theory to really bridge the conversation around men who have partners that are both male and female. And that project seems to be working well now because it's helping them to look at different segments of their life. Where did you get to where you're at now around your thought process in regards to risk? And that happens on an individual level. So there's different styles of interventions. And I know you're probably working with, what, Sister to Sister?
Well, that's another one.
That's another one.
Sister to Sister, which actually...
Well, you were like, that's another one.
Sister to Sister, which actually is
See, we had to know more about you than you do.
Which is for women who are at high risk of becoming infected with HIV and other STDs.
What are risk factors? Maybe the audience, I hate to interrupt you, but
it's okay.
When you say high risk factors, could you give us a couple of those high risk factors that people should be worried about? That they're not worried about, apparently, sometimes?
Unprotected sex.
Okay.
Not knowing of your partner's status.
Okay.
Not knowing of your own status.
Multiple partners.
Any type of substance abuse. Okay. Whether you're drinking or using any type of drugs could put you at risk.
In my experience, when I had to go through the STD trainings and stuff, that what was important, one of the things that I left that training with was the thought that I'm responsible for me and that I need to make sure that what I do is protective for me in the sense of dealing with, I assume there's some of that going on.
Yes, and I think, again, gay, straight, for women, learning how, and especially women of color, learning how to take ownership of self.
Okay.
And again, understanding that, hey, this is my body, I need to take care of me, regardless of what issues you have going with you. I can't determine my sexual health off of yours.
Right.
And sometimes people are quick to do that. Well, my partner's test came back negative, so I must be negative. That's not necessarily the case. So women being able to take ownership, and that's what a lot of the interventions for women, as we were talking about Sister to Sister, it's that one-on-one conversation that you would have with another individual woman, looking at her sexual risk, having her identify what her risks are, and her understanding that, hey, wow, I never thought that I could be put at risk, because we always have the perception, it's not me, exactly. It's them.
Exactly.
And I'm still trying to figure out who them, they,
yeah, who they are.
Those out there are. There's another one, SISTA, which stands for Sisters Informing Sisters on Topics of AIDS, which is a 5-session intervention. And it looks at everything, the big components surrounding HIV, condom negotiation, other STDs, having that
condom negotiation.
Yes, condom negotiation. How do you talk to your partner about using a condom?
Okay.
Also, looking at having her again assess her risk for HIV and other STDs. There's a lot of poetry from a lot of African American women that's in there, and really, this intervention looks at women understanding that we're in this together. Looking at sister love and allowing women to understand that they are important, that they are someone. Mm-hmm. Self-esteem. Mm-hmm. Also plays a part in a lot of these interventions, and really it doesn't focus more so on the sex, but the bigger things. I think we've talked about social communication.
Yeah. Communication, social
right.
stuff.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's what a lot of the interventions for women of color look at.
Mm-hmm. See, it sounds a little bit like you're coaching. You know, they say coaching in the field, you're helping people formulate a way in which they should be more conscious of the world in which they live in.
Right.
And be able to, like, navigate through really treacherous waters that are out there right now. It sounds...
We're living in what I like to call lost times. We're living in hurtful times right now, where it's like, I just want to be loved. And everybody, I feel like, I don't know, in our community, it's just, they want to be loved. Mm-hmm. For women, I know that it's always easy for a lot of older women to put fault on these young girls, or look at these girls out here nowadays, they're just fast. But it's like, they're no different than you. Mm-hmm. They're doing the same thing you did when you were younger.
True.
Some have just gotten caught. But maybe this young girl just wants a hug. Has anyone ever stopped and say, hey, how are you doing today? Everything's gonna be okay. Mm-hmm. But instead, if she meets the love of her life, a man who just said, wow, you look beautiful in those socks.
Right.
She's just excited because someone spoke to her and took up some of her time. So that little 5-minute conversation could just end up in her just having unprotected sex with someone just so she can feel appreciated for one day.
So true, so true.
Yeah, and I'm just wondering, like, what are some of the key issues you're seeing among young MSM? Because you guys have a program, as you said, on Tuesday and Thursday nights, I believe it is, that really targets young MSM. And so wondering, what are some of the key issues you're seeing that young MSM communities are dealing with?
Chief issues that I see oftentimes come out, or some of the themes are around addressing their sexuality. You know, really, coming into who they are and what does that mean. I mean, I often kind of call it, multiple personality disorder, for young black MSM, because it's like, you have to be this for this group of people. So I'm this way in front of my family. I'm this way when I'm in my religious institution. I'm this way when I'm amongst my peers in the LGBT community. It's like, I have to switch hats. And I think for our younger folks that they're dealing with, trying to navigate their sexuality and their sexual identity, about who they are and how does that translate to the people that are important around them, oftentimes is a chief issue. The other thing is really trying to, figure out how to get through systems. I mean, for some of our younger LGBT folks who do not have strong biological support systems, that don't have the mother, the father, the grandmother, auntie that is really kind of looking out for them, are being self-sufficient. So they're kind of, pushed out very early, exposed to the streets, and really kind of learn as they go. And they don't have a lot of that coaching that we talked about. So they don't have the role models. And then the role models themselves, are dealing with their own issues. I think that oftentimes, I look at it in the field of work that, you have broken people trying to help broken people. Mm-hmm. And that becomes very challenging. But I think that oftentimes is, a faulty mechanism that we have to kind of go by, because folks are trying to get by themselves. And so for many of our young folks, they're trying to get by, they're trying to do what they need to do so that they can maintain some type of life. You know, and part of that might be making sacrifices. You know, as Sade mentioned that, you know, I might sacrifice, you know, my own health at the sake of, you know, this person loving me, or me thinking that this person loves me. So that oftentimes is the challenge. I mean, yesterday we had our board met with the young folks for the first time, our new board of directors. And, you know, there was a session happening at that point in time, and they were talking about relationships. And they asked the question, how many of you have an issue around trust in your relationship? And it was like we had over 50 young folks in the room, and about 95% of them raised their hand. Trust is an issue for them. So, you know, if you think about that being the response, if they don't trust the folks that they're entering into relationships with, how do you expect those relationships to translate into healthy outcomes for those individuals? And that was a shocker, particularly for our board of directors and, you know, for the folks that were facilitating that group, because we see that there's issues. Mm-hmm. Folks are looking to find that love and, you know, that, you know, the self-affirmation through someone else, but that someone else might be somebody that they don't trust.
And, you know, I sort of want to make sure also, you know, and the social worker in me, I guess, comes out and is like, all right, you know, that we don't want to have some strengths perspective here as well, because I know that we're sort of talking about some of the challenges within communities, but also just want to talk about some of the strengths, because obviously you talked earlier about HIV being a chronic disease and people living with it and not dying from it, which I think is an important perspective for people to have, right, of living with disease versus dying from it. But so what are some of the more affirming aspects of work that you're doing out there in the community or that you're seeing with the populations that you work with?
Mm-hmm. I think for me, a lot of the individual women who are living their lives, healthy relationships, working, in school, happy, are those who have those strong support systems. Those who are able to say, hey, look, this is something that has happened. It is what it is. I am more than HIV. I am a woman who is a strong mother, fabulous grandmother, fun-loving person. These are the same individuals who come to the doctor, who are forefront with their healthcare, who advocate for, you know, treatment. Mm-hmm. You know, if they don't have access to possibly paying for their medication, they know the resources that they can go to help them take care of themselves. Mm-hmm. In 2011, like you said, you do not have to die. By no means at all. I lost a girlfriend about 3 or 4 years ago to AIDS complications, and I always tell people that she had a passive suicide. She wanted to die because her mom and dad weren't telling her they loved her. She was raising two kids by herself, two fathers that one was in jail for life, the other one she didn't know who it was, and she was tired. She was, I'm tired of taking these pills. I'm tired of going to the doctor. I'm tired of the doctor giving me all this whoop-de-woo that I don't even understand. I'm tired and I can't do this anymore. Mm-hmm. And only so many people could help her up and allow her to know that you can do this. Mm-hmm. You know, and some people think, okay, she was taking 3 pills a day, but those 3 pills were a reminder of this is something that I have to live with and deal with for the rest of my life. So to individuals who are out here, who are living, or who have just received a new diagnosis, I always tell them to find a support system. And as you stated, Rob, even if it's the individuals that you have met in the HIV/AIDS community from support groups, your doctor could be your biggest support. Mm-hmm. It could be that social worker that you just want to call and cry and yell and cuss and get everything out to. Mm-hmm. That there are people who are actually out here in the community that are saying, hey, I love you regardless of whatever it is. Let's move forward. What is it that you need from me to give you that push forward, that life goes on?
I think for our folks, young and old in our agency, you know, you see a lot of that kind of camaraderie around community. Community is important. I think, you know, for African-American LGBT individuals to be able to say, I can connect to something that's greater than me, we see that. I mean, on, you know, our young people on Tuesday nights, you see all the energy, the excitement, the angst.
I've seen some of it too. I've been there on a Tuesday night.
So it's like, you know, they kind of come together, and it's like it's such support that they build around each other that they believe that, you know, there's something greater than the experience that they're actually going through. Mm-hmm. You know, and you know, for our older community that you know see that you see working in our other groups, you see that same type of thing. It's like, I need to be there so that I can stay connected because, you know, this is my reason why. You know, so whether living with the disease or not living with the disease, I think that mm-hmm. for many of the individuals, you know, for within our community, they recognize the importance of having a community to go to mm-hmm. because that's oftentimes going to be the reasons why they continue to thrive day to day.
You almost get the impression that when it first started, we were so crazy about the medical aspects of mm-hmm. it, the death and dying, and mm-hmm. that as we made this transition through the 90s and into, you know, 2005, 2007, we realized that the multiplicity of that disorder, mm-hmm. that we need to socialize and right. communicate and support.
I think you know, for Black communities, you have to begin to address the other isms mm-hmm. before you can really attack HIV. I mean, it's you know there's a lot of work now being done around structural interventions. We talk about community, group, mm-hmm. and individual, but you know, with biomedical interventions that are coming out, looking at kind of trying to do you know medical treatment that, you know, can treat individuals that are high risk and they can take a pill medication, mm-hmm. You know, to reduce their likelihood of infection, you know, to work around HIV vaccine works. That's the biomedical stuff, but around structural interventions, it's really around changing some of the social structures that are in place around why the epidemic is the disproportionate in our community. Employment, you know, poverty, housing, mm-hmm. you know, all of those things, you know, education, you know, educational attainment, mm-hmm. you know, all relate to HIV.
True.
Folks
true,
are like, well, what does employment have to do with it? Well, if I don't have a job, then that means I'm going to do what I need to do to survive, mm-hmm. you know, and if that means I'm going to get out there and I'm going to have, you know, multiple partners because each one of these partners are able to provide for me financially and true. Fiscally able to sustain me in a different kind of way because I'm not able to sustain myself, then I'm going to have multiple partners. Right. And if I have those multiple partners, I may not have a mm-hmm. conversation about, what, you know, using condoms. So then that ties back into HIV, you know, and I think that, you know, the work that we do oftentimes really is around trying to change some of the, you know, social stratifications that exist within the African American community, because until we begin to address those, the epidemic is going to continue to be disproportionate because we're focusing on, okay, let me tell you how to put a condom on. Let me tell you about, you know, this is how to have safe sex. Let me tell you about the four fluids and the four ways HIV is transmitted. We talk to you about all that, but I don't tell you about how do you get a job. How do you address the housing issue that you don't have to be this, you don't have to sofa surf and live from friend to friend because you don't have a steady, you know, place to lay your head at night? We don't talk about those issues, but they're very interrelated into all of that, you know, knowledge-based stuff that we mm-hmm. try to give individuals around HIV. I can't worry about HIV if I have to worry about all these other things.
True.
And that's what we have to work on changing.
Let me digress for a moment.
Sure.
Go back to HIV 101.
Go ahead.
What are the four mm-hmm. fluids that we're talking about?
Four fluids. Blood.
semen.
Breast milk.
Vaginal fluids.
There you go. Oh, yeah.
ding, 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 ding.
Ding, ding.
There you go.
So, and we might be able to, I think we have a few more minutes. I wouldn't mind concentrating a little bit on pregnancy. Mm. And some of the issues around birth and what happens with the child and what we need to protect ourselves against in mm. the sense of those kinds of topics, and maybe some others too, but mm-hmm. I thought that would be an interesting one because of the issue of
mm-hmm. prenatal care is very, very significantly important yeah. with an individual woman who is HIV positive or HIV negative. In the case if she is HIV negative, during her time of pregnancy, she will be offered an HIV test. Mm-hmm. And everybody's still striving that they have to take this test, and I'm waiting for the day that they say yes, any individual woman who is pregnant must get tested. They still can opt out, but mm-hmm. there's still a lot of challenges.
No matter where you are, you get right. tested.
There's still a lot of challenges that come with that if you do opt out. Now, for a woman, and for the most part, a lot of African-American young women are receiving their test results during pregnancy. In the case that this is, I don't want to say a happy, joyous thing, but it's a good thing because now you can start taking better care of yourself and your child from not becoming infected. Mm-hmm. During this time, you will go to see an infectious disease doctor, and they will start you off on medication, usually during the end of your first trimester of pregnancy or after 3 months. And again, because of the advancement of medication,
right, yeah, mm-hmm. Tremendous strides.
Like, you're not taking tons of pills. Mm-hmm. So whichever pills your physician recommends for you, you'll be asked to take these medications throughout your whole pregnancy. It's always important to talk to your doctor about any type of side effects mm-hmm. during this time.
And it has no negative effects on the
No negative effects of developments on the child thus far because of research.
Right.
When the mother goes in for delivery, the mother is placed on liquid AZT through IV.
Mm-hmm. AZT is, I don't know how many people out there.
Can you pronounce that for me?
Well, you don't have to name it, but it's
I can't pronounce what AZT is, actually the acronym, but it's an antiretroviral.
That's right. That's what I meant. I didn't necessarily mean what
it is. It's okay. That's what I was asking.
I forget what it means. I forget what it means myself, But it's an antiviral. That's what I meant.
Correct. The mother will be placed on liquid AZT. Depending upon, this could be getting a little deep, but depending upon the mother's CD4, white blood count, and viral load, the mother can have a vaginal delivery. Okay. So HIV positive pregnant women are now able to have vaginal deliveries.
Hmm. Otherwise, there's cesarean.
Correct. Okay. And again, it's all based upon your CD4 count. We want the CD4 count to be high, viral load to be low, therefore undetectable. Mm-hmm. Therefore, there's no transmission. During the time the child is born, once the child is born, the child is placed on liquid AZT as well.
For a couple months,
yes, I think through a syringe, liquid AZT every 6 hours for 2 weeks.
Okay, 2 weeks.
The baby then will go to see an infectious disease doctor here in Philadelphia. It's either St. Christopher's Hospital or Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. Both practices are excellent with seeing women who are positive, and especially their kids. Mm-hmm. The babies are tested 3 months, 6 months, and at a year. And after a year, if all test results come back negative, and for the most part they have, as long as the mother is compliant during pregnancy mm-hmm. and with the child after birth, then the baby can go to see whatever pediatric physician they would like.
And I'm almost sure, because I have to read all this material myself for classes. Mm-hmm. I think it's what, less than 2%?
Less than 2%.
Yeah, less than 2%.
Less than 2%.
From this experience, only about 2% of the births
from
mother to child will be.
Mm-hmm. Right. Philadelphia has been very successful and aggressive around prenatal care for our HIV positive women here in the city of Philadelphia to reduce the likelihood of HIV positive transmission from mother to child. So you're least likely to see that happen here in the city of Philadelphia because of the phenomenal work of our health department and the programs that support that, as she mentioned, CHOP and St. Chris.
Right, and just really encouraging the mother to get tested during the time.
That's
of
important.
Pregnancy.
Yeah.
It is. It's very important.
And obviously she can't breastfeed.
Right.
No.
Right.
During that time.
And she will be told that several times throughout her doctor's visit and after the child is born that breastfeeding is not recommended at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have that. There's, I guess, a lot of experiences where you can relate to that story. For example, women who are on methadone in the city, you know, the same thing. They can't.
Correct.
Breastfeed because the child will then
develop
wind
addiction.
Up addicted to methadone. Mm-hmm. To be
There's
honest.
A wonderful organization, Circle of Care, who has peer counselors. And these individual peer counselors will go out to the different clinics throughout the city of Philadelphia that provide services to women who are HIV positive and pregnant. And they will be a support system to them. They will come with them to doctor's visits. They will help to further explain if there's something the doctor has mentioned. If they don't understand, the peer is there to help them. Mm-hmm. The peer is also there. AZT is not like Tylenol, where you can just go to the Rite Aid and get it. Mm-hmm. If they need help, maybe getting the AZT from the hospital to their home, these peers are able to help them during this process. So the Circle of Care has been very phenomenal with helping to provide services and that additional support to HIV-positive pregnant women.
Great.
And I know I think we're sort of getting towards the end, but I definitely want to make sure that I gave some time because I know the Colors is celebrating its 20-year anniversary this
Woo!
Year.
Yes,
20 years. And which is really great because there's not many indigenously black MSM or gay institutions left across the country, and Colors is one of the very few. Right.
Well, that's it for the Tapestry of Life for today. I want to thank our guests for being with us today. For more information about the Department of Behavioral Health and Human Services, you can contact me, Dr. Pascal Scoles. See you next time.
Mm-hmm.